Six Filipino firms make it to Time Magazine's list of best companies this year. Ayala Corporation was the highest-ranked Filipino company, ranking 309th. San Miguel Corporation came in at 347th, while Jollibee was at 421st place. Also making the list were PLDT, Metrobank, and BDO. Now, topping that list was Microsoft, followed by other U.S. tech giants, Apple, Alphabet, and Meta.
In today's numbers that matter, 10,816, that's the number of aspiring Filipino lawyers who will take this year's bar examinations. Of that figure, more than half are first-time takers. The bar exams will be held on 3 dates starting September 17, Sunday, and on the 20th and the 24th. To the bar takers, the best of luck.
The Philippine Presidential Palace says India's GMR Group has expressed interest to invest in Manila's airport, roads, and energy projects. Malacañang says GMR Group's top executives met with President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. in Singapore on the sidelines of the 10th Asia Summit. GMR officials said they will provide long-term solutions to the Philippines' infrastructure and energy sectors. Marcos, meanwhile, said he is impressed by GMR's achievements and hope the Indian firm can take part in the country's infrastructure development. GMR is one of the 5 potential bidders for the 170.6 billion peso NAIA public-private partnership project.
The United Auto Workers Union launches simultaneous strikes against all 3 Detroit automakers, kicking off the most ambitious U.S. industrial labor action in decades. Over 12,000 workers of General Motors, Ford Motor, and Stellantis will be on strike after the companies failed to reach a deal with the union by the Thursday deadline. This even as President Joe Biden got involved by talking to the union's leader and officials of the Detroit automakers. Among the union's demands, higher wages, reduced working hours, and the elimination of compensation tiers, among others. The walkouts will halt production of the Ford Bronco, Jeep Wrangler, and Chevrolet Colorado, along with other popular models. Better than expected economic data from China, retail sales and industrial output in the world's second largest economy picked up pace in August, offering relief for its sputtering recovery. Retail sales were up 4.6% last month, from toned-down expectations of 3%. Industrial production also grew by 4.5%, but Friday's data were not all that good. It also showed new home prices falling at its fastest pace in 10 months as the slump in China's property sector worsened. On Thursday, China's central bank cut the reserve ratio requirement for lenders, marking the second time it slashed the triple R this year to boost recovery. Let's wrap up the trading week now. Most markets in Asia Pacific are capping off Friday on a positive note. Notably, the Shanghai Composite is sole market in the red as traders grow more concerned over China's property sector. In share price movements, we're seeing shares of YG Entertainment down by 3% today. That's amid reports a member of the famed Blackpink has rejected a contract renewal offer from the talent agency. Seoul Media says Lisa turned down 2 offers from YG, with the contract reportedly amounting to as much as $37 million. Let's take a look now at futures in Europe. They are set to mirror the rally in Asia following the better-than-expected Chinese data. Sentiment already got a boost Thursday after the European Central Bank signaled an end to its rate-hiking cycle. Over in Wall Street, futures tied to the major U.S. indices are up about 0.25% each, on track to a winning streak. It's a data-heavy day, though, with U.S. industrial and manufacturing numbers as well as a consumer sentiment reading due out today. The war in Ukraine is likely to be the big topic for the second year in a row when leaders gather at the United Nations General Assembly next week. Many developing countries now are hoping to shine a light on issues on development, inflation, as well as climate change. More in this report.
This year's General Assembly is taking place after a marathon month of summits and meetings, and some high-profile leaders are skipping the annual gathering. But there will still be plenty to talk about.
We'll be gathering at a time when humanity faces huge challenges, from the worsening climate emergency to escalating conflicts, the global cost of living crisis, soaring inequalities, and dramatic technological disruptions. And people are looking to their leaders for a way out of this mess.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky is expected to attend in person for the first time since Russia invaded his country in February 2022. It is an opportunity for him to appeal for international support, but he must also walk a diplomatic fine line.
Zelensky does have to be conscious that there are a lot of leaders from developing countries who have problems of their own, such as debt and poor economic growth. And they want to talk about those topics and not just the war between Russia and Ukraine.
That includes sustainable development, which is off track for meeting 2030 targets to end hunger and extreme poverty. The UN says if present trends continue, a staggering 575 million people will remain trapped in extreme poverty by the end of this decade. A two-day summit that the UN hopes revitalizes the goals will begin the high-level week.
Progress has been set back significantly in recent years. This is in part due to the lingering drag of the COVID-19 pandemic, the highest level of armed conflict globally since 1945, and climate-related disasters, as well as inflation and the rising cost of living.
There will also be a climate action summit on Wednesday that requires ambitious commitments to cut greenhouse gas emissions and phase out fossil fuels for leaders to get a place at the podium. And the UN Security Council will also meet that day at the highest level to discuss the war in Ukraine. President Zelensky is expected to attend. The Secretary General says there is space to discuss both the war in Ukraine and other pressing issues during the week. He said rescuing the SDGs is urgent.
I believe that there is room for all issues to be seriously discussed, and I am not afraid that the different crises we are witnessing in different parts of the world, that they will take out of the agenda the importance of the SDGs.
President Joe Biden will address the General Assembly on Tuesday morning, laying out U.S. priorities.
He will address the General Assembly, where he will reaffirm our country's leadership in countering threats to international peace and security, protecting human rights, and advancing global prosperity and development.
With much on the line, the world's citizens will be looking to leaders to take action to improve their daily lives and safeguard their future. Margaret Bashir, VOA News, the United Nations.
Time for some corporate stories. The proposed merger between the Bank of Philippine Islands and Robinsons Bank gets the green light from the country's antitrust agency. The Ayala-owned bank is the third largest Philippine lender in terms of assets, with the Gokongwei-led lender at 16th. Aside from PCC approval, BPI, which will become the surviving entity of the merger, will also need the approval of the Central Bank and the Securities and Exchange Commission. For Wholesome Philippines, it says 233 million of its common shares were tendered during the first tranche of its tender offer. This represents approximately 3.62% of the company's outstanding common shares. And finally, Cebu Pacific says its fleet availability next year may be affected by a manufacturing issue by engine maker Pratt & Whitney. Setback says, though, that this is not a safety issue. It adds the airline was assured by the American manufacturer that it has the expertise and resources to resolve the matter efficiently. Setback also says it will have 76 units of aircraft this year, which it expects to grow by 91 in 2024.